Let's come tonight to the subject of mercy killing. We're dealing with terminal illness. Keep in mind what the subject is. This only has reference with respect to the question of terminal illness that so many, if not most people, eventually are faced with. It doesn't have reference to a person who isn't going to confess something like terminal illness. We recognize the Bible says, in Adam all die, and death entered the world by one man. Death came to all men. It can be a death like Moses and not terminal cases of drugged into oblivion. So under the subject of terminal illness is the subject of euthanasia, which every Christian should have a biblical view on, or the popular term mercy killing. And of course, the ethical question, is it ever justified? Of course, you could say no, but let's look at it. We know that it's no, but some people think yes. Some people who would abhor the crime of murder, yet contend that in some cases, medical science ought to provide for a way rather than prolonging life to terminate it. See, this is the opposite to what we've been looking at. The practice of medical science in prolonging in a vegetable state people who are terminally ill who are going to die anyway, because the medical attitude toward the word death is so extreme. This is the opposite, though. Some contend that in cases like where they're hopelessly ill, where they're in a permanent coma, constant pain, where they're going to die anyway, a person who's badly mutilated, say in an accident, that the medical authorities ought to be given the right to inject some sort of drug that would give them a painless and swift death. And they call this, of course, mercy killing. That the individual would welcome it. Of course, sometimes people do ask for others, you know, to end their misery. One in the Old Testament did that, if you remember. King Saul. See, he was dying anyway, and so his request was that they put him out of his misery as quickly as possible. Is it ever justified? Some think, yes, that this would be an act of mercy, a painless death, and it sometimes happens that a doctor will do this. Of course, there's no way to ever find it out, but it does happen. And it happens when it does get found out, where a husband or wife may not be able to endure the agony of the other and gives them an overdose of sleeping pills or something. Of course, the authorities frown on that, but it does happen. Or they put a suffering person, often with their consent, out of their misery. Now, looking back to last week in our studies about terminal illness and the individual's right to die, there are those who contend that we should use every means to sustain life as long as possible without, you know, asking the question of what kind of life they're sustaining. They say that to unplug the machine, as in the case that we cited of the young woman who was kept alive in a vegetable state for a year, to unplug the machine would be passive euthanasia. So they have a term for that. To make it sound as bad as they can, they call unplugging the machine or taking them off of the antibiotics and oxygen tent. Even though they're going to die in 48 hours, to do that they would call passive euthanasia. That is, that you're actually killing them. But such cases that we cited last week could not be termed passive euthanasia for the simple reason that the patient could not survive without all of that life-sustaining equipment, which keeps them alive artificially. Now, as we've already said, they're not really alive. They're not aware of what's going on. What runs through the tube in the nose is emptied into a bag at the foot of the bed. And that goes on and on and on. But we covered all that. Trust you heard it. It's not passive euthanasia not to do that, because the patient wouldn't survive without it. They would die except you use such methods. They're really only clinically alive. They're not really alive, they're clinically alive. That is, the gauge on the machine says they're alive. Another machine says their heart is beating, their blood's flowing. Doctor uses his stethoscope, says, yes, I can detect a faint heartbeat. where I can feel a faint pulse. And you unplug the machine, he couldn't feel either, or detect either. But before the invention of such machines, they would have died a natural death. We covered that last week. In fact, they're going to die anyway, so it isn't passive euthanasia. We have to make a distinction between what we're talking about tonight and what we talked about last week. In one case, we're talking about the right to die. An individual has the right to die with dignity. Now, we're talking about death as it affects the human race. Not to sustain life artificially in some vegetable state is what we were discussing then. But tonight, we're talking about promoting death artificially. Last week, sustaining life artificially is wrong, but it's also wrong to promote death artificially. That would be euthanasia, by any means, whether you just give an overdose of something. So mercy killing is, according to Scripture, the violation of the commandment, thou shalt not kill. What mercy killing is assassination, it's murder. The Bible looks with disfavor on it. If you want to turn to 1 Samuel 31, you'll see that the Word of God looks with disfavor on euthanasia. 1 Samuel 31. This is the case of King Saul, who, because of his disobedience, God said that he would die. 1 Samuel 31, the first few verses, we see this. And now the Philistines fought against Israel, and the men of Israel fled from before the Philistines and fell down slain in Mount Gilboa. And the Philistines followed hard upon Saul, upon his sons, and the Philistines slew Jonathan and Abinadab and Melchishua, Saul's sons. The battle went sore against Saul, and the archers hit him, and he was sore wounded of the archers. That means critically wounded. Then said Saul unto the armor bearer, draw thy sword and thrust me through therewith, lest these uncircumcised come and thrust me through and abuse me. But his armor bearer would not, for he was sore afraid. Therefore Saul took a sword and fell upon it. And when his armor bearer saw that Saul was dead, he fell likewise upon his sword and died with him. So Saul died. Now, if you turn over to 2 Samuel, you'll see the consequence of that. The whole record isn't there because a young man came along, an Amalekite, and discovered Saul not yet dead. And we take that up in chapter 1 of 2 Samuel. Now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, that David abode 2 days in Ziklag. It came to pass on the third day that, behold, a man came out of the camp from Saul with his clothes rent and earth upon his head. And so it was, when he came to David, that he fell to the earth and did obeisance. And David said unto him, from whence comest thou? And he said, out of the camp of Israel am I escaped. And David said unto him, how went the matter? So he tells him that Saul lost the battle and they were all killed. And then verse 6, a young man told him and said, as I happened by chance upon Mount Gilboa, behold, Saul leaned upon his spear. And lo, the chariots and horsemen followed hard after him. In other words, he's been wounded by an arrow, he falls on his own sword, he still isn't dead, so he finds him propped up on his spear. Now that can mean he's lying down, in fact, and just holding on to his spear. But whatever it means, he isn't dead yet. And when he looked behind him, he saw me and called unto me, and I answered, here am I. And he said unto me, who art thou? And I answered him, I am an Amalekite. And he said unto him, again, stand, I pray thee, over me and slay me, for anguish is come upon me because my life is yet whole in me. So I stood over him and slew him because I was sure that he could not live after that he was fallen. So obviously he's down, even though he's sort of leaning on his spear. So I took the crown that was on his head, the bracelet that was on his arm, and I brought them hither unto my Lord. Well, David rent his clothes and all with him, and so they mourned until evening. And then, verse 13, David said to the young man that told him, whence art thou? He answered, I am a son of a stranger, I am an Amalekite. And David said unto him, how wast thou not afraid to stretch forth thine hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? Now this is terminal illness. See, a case of terminal illness. He's not only been wounded with an arrow which will kill him, but he's tried to commit suicide, fallen on his own sword. He still isn't dead, but it's certainly a terminal case. And David said, why weren't you afraid to stretch forth your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? And David called one of the young men and said, go near and fall upon him. And he smote him that he died. And David said to him, thy blood be upon thy head, for thy mouth has testified against thee, saying, I have slain the Lord's anointed. Now, it doesn't take a lot of education or discernment to see the biblical attitude toward euthanasia. There is a case where if anybody's going to die pretty quick, it's going to be Saul, but somehow he hasn't expired yet, and yet David treats it as assassination, so much so that he pronounces a death sentence, which in those days he had the right to do, death sentence upon the man who, in mercy, obeyed Saul's own wishes. Saul asked for it, but that was not sufficient. Well, I know there's sometimes when people without faith and without the Word of God in their hearts and out there in the world could rationalize that, well, she's going to die anyway, it's just a matter of a few days and she's suffering unbearable pain and just a few extra sleeping pills at her own request, you know, which often happens, could end her misery. Why should she suffer another week? She's going to die anyway. And rationalize it. But the Bible treats life as something precious. Even though it's slowly or rapidly waning away, it treats us as precious because of the commandment, thou shalt not kill. Take, for example, the case of Job in chapter 2. Now, you talk about a person in misery. If you ever had a justification for jumping out of the window, which some do, I guess you could say he had it, if there is a justification. He lost all of his property and goods, lost all of his loved ones, except his wife, and he himself covered with a loathsome disease, boils from head to toe. How many of you ever had a boil? One boil. Oh, well, the rest of you are blessed. One boil. That's what the Hebrew says. He had boils from head to toe. And they just oozed. Not only are they painful, but they all oozed. And he was in such a stinking, miserable state, he went out on the ash heap and took a broken piece of pottery and would scrape the corruption off of him. And yet, the loss of all of that, in spite of all that, he treated his wife's suggestion as foolishness when she said, why don't you curse God and die? Because even in all that misery, life is precious. There's something wrong with a person that wants to hasten the end of it. Well, of course, Saul had something wrong with him. Disobedience, many other things. But life is precious in the Bible. Only God, according to the Bible, only God has the right to terminate it. Hebrews 9:27. It's given unto men once to die, and after that the judgment. Only God has the right to terminate it, even though man with his sometimes misplaced compassion and emotion may try to justify it rationally. Only God has the right to terminate it. That's why you shouldn't try to sustain it when Genesis 3 and Romans 5 say it should be terminated. That is, sustain a terminal patient in a vegetable state artificially. The teaching of the last 2 weeks will explain what we mean by that. Because even some doctors question the use made by medical science of its skills to try to prove they can keep a person in a vegetable state and then send you a whopping big bill. Like the woman, 80, mentally ill with many ailments, suffered a heart attack, and medical science got the glory of keeping her alive 2 extra days with oxygen and drugs and all sorts of treatments, and then sent the family a big bill. Now, there's something wrong with that kind of medical treatment. And yet, that is practiced again and again. Former nurse from this body said, I'm amazed at how you understand these things, because she said, that's exactly what happens in the hospitals. She's out of it now, but she says, that's right, that's what they do. Well, it's pretty gruesome. You should hear the tape of last week if you haven't. But the scriptures give us another alternative in such cases. of so-called terminal illness, and that is divine healing of the incurably ill person. So euthanasia isn't an answer, or anything else. Divine healing is the answer. We've seen mental and physical illnesses healed just by the prayer of faith. Okay, that's our study of terminal illness, and on the basis of that we come to death, and then thirdly will be the funeral. Then after that we'll take up some moral questions about special things like suicide and so forth. Now we come to death. The scriptural attitude toward death is twofold. It's very important that you see this. Most Christians do not have a biblical attitude toward death. And again, it isn't criticism, it's just where people live. Like one woman, I preached one sermon in the church back when I used to preach in a lot of denominational churches. I still came on pretty strong even before I heard of the Holy Ghost. I was preaching on Second Advent. Oh, she said, that makes us nervous. Shouldn't preach on death and Second Advent. Just pleasant things. We ought to come to church to be made happy and be filled with joy. Well, of course, you know the answer to that. There's something wrong with a person that's afraid to face death and yet says, I'm a Christian. Death doesn't hold any morbid fears for a true Christian. And if they do for you, then you need deliverance from a spirit of fear or wrong teaching or both. That's right. Death should hold no fears for a Christian. In fact, if we aren't misunderstood in saying it, sense in which it would be welcomed. We got Bible verses for that one. For what does it mean to be absent from the body, but present with the Lord? Paul wasn't trying to hold on to this old physical frame because he cherished it. Now you see, the Bible cherishes life, the life principle. That's why we have commandments against taking it or ending it ourselves or whatever. At the same time, our existence in this world is as a pilgrim. We're just passing through. So there's a scriptural attitude toward death. It's twofold. And it's important to know this because, as I said, most do not have a biblical conception of death. Two principles we should keep in mind: that the reality and certainty of death, the reality and certainty of the tragic nature of death, the tragic nature of death should never be minimized or misrepresented. The reality and certainty of the tragic nature of death should never be minimized or misrepresented. Now, what we're saying at this point is the most important thing under the subject of death, so listen carefully and God can show you something. Now, why is the reality in death, its tragic nature, not to be minimized or covered over, glossed over, as it is, you know, at the funerals, they're over there, they're departed, they're on the other side, they're not dead. You don't hear dead or death at any funeral, except one maybe that we've conducted where we read scripture. And the Bible says don't mourn over the dead like those who sorrow with no hope. But anyway, why should the reality and certainty of the tragic nature, we said tragic nature of death. See, death is quite abnormal. And it should not be hidden that it's abnormal. Death was not intended for man. Life was intended for man. So why that statement we just gave you? Because the Bible repeatedly confronts us with the reality of death and its death due to sin. The Bible everywhere confronts us with the reality and certainty of death, and it's always death due to sin. Romans 5. Why do men die? Romans 5:12. Because of sin. That should never be minimized. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, because all have sinned. You're born into the world with a sinful nature, and the first choice you make out of the womb is sinful, selfish, centered around I, look at me, minister to me, take care of me. Stop the world while you change my diaper, fill my bottle. And the whole message of discipleship is denial of self. But it's just human nature. I want to be ministered to. I want attention. Plus all of the other things we've said about those little angels that we raise, we discover are not quite angels when they can make even moral choices. But it's death due to sin, so we shouldn't minimize that. And so why we're saying this, or why the Bible says it, is that men will never fear God and see their need of repentance unless they are confronted with these three ideas that one day he will die. A sinner will not fear God or be led to repentance unless he is confronted with the fact that one day he will die. That secondly, it can happen at any moment. And thirdly, he better be prepared to meet God. For it's appointed unto men once to die, but after that, the judgment. So he needs to be confronted with the fact that he's going to die and he's going to face judgment. And we can't gloss over death and use other terms and try to beautify. We'll get into that later in the funeral. That's the third one. Terminal illness, death, funeral. But when you try to gloss over the fact that that corpse is dead, death's a horrible thing. It's abnormal. Tragic. God wants us not to forget it. People today are not confronted with death because if they get a little sick, they rush them off the hospital and they issue them into a limbo between life and death with drugs where they stay there and then they pass away, cover up the face immediately. You're not even around. Family is seldom around. Wheel them off to the undertaker. He beautifies and perfumes the corpse. When you see it in a satin-filled coffin with perfume and flowers, you get the idea death's not so bad after all. Doesn't he look peaceful? Doesn't she look natural? No, quite unnatural. You see, in our culture, we're kind of getting ahead of the story, but the funeral with the open casket display of the corpse is American from the word go. Other cultures think it's abhorrent to display the dead. The body isn't to be mutilated or to be disfigured or shown disrespect for, but it's to be put away as quickly as possible, because that isn't the person any longer. That's a clay shell. So the first aspect of the scriptural attitude is that the reality and certainty of death, the tragic nature of it, should never be minimized. It would be a healthy thing for every person to see a person die. Now, I say that in context of teaching on the subject. I don't recommend that you do or have to, but if there's no other way to get across to you, if you can't get it out of the Word, the tragic nature of death, if you've never seen a person die. And here again, we're not speaking of a person who can go peacefully asleep, not with all the screams and the agony that so many go out of this life with, but we're talking about the majority of people. Sad. I've been in the hospital back in those days when I used to go that route enough that you'd be around enough to see people die. Well, it isn't pleasant. It's a harsh fact. Funeral directors are guilty of obscuring the awful reality of death. Of course, most people want to go along with it. It's a lot more pleasant to let a person pass away in a hospital, and they didn't die, they passed away. And when you see them, why, they look a bit artificial, but at least they look better than they did the last time you saw them in the hospital. And so the American culture has accepted that. The rest of the world laughs at us. Now, the other aspect of the scriptural attitude is this, that genuine Christians who have been taught the proper meaning of death and the blessed hope of the resurrection will not sorrow as those who have no hope when they lose a loved one. Death is tragic, but there's another side. A Christian is not going to sorrow as those who have no hope. Doesn't say he won't sorrow, but not as those who have no hope. If he knows what the Bible has to say about where the person is immediately, if he's a Christian, upon death. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It's good to know the scriptural attitude toward death. that it's tragic, and yet for a Christian, the tragedy of it has been overcome in the hope of the resurrection. That is 1 Thessalonians 4. Well, a familiar passage to some, but it may be fairly new to some of you, and it would help you to know that Paul said, verse 13, I would not have you to be ignorant concerning them that are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not go before them that are asleep. King James prevent means to precede. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. How about that? The dead in Christ rise first. We which are alive and remain don't go off and leave them. We don't take off and up in the clouds somewhere. Hurry up, hurry up. You've been dead a long time. Catch up with us. No, the dead in Christ rise first. Then we which are alive and remain at the second advent shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Amen. Some people wonder how I hold up at funerals. If it's a Christian, I don't have any trouble, even the person that I know. It doesn't mean that I'm glad to see them go, but I'm happy for where they are. Amen. I wouldn't have to have 1 Thessalonians 4 to rejoice in the fact they're with the Lord. I don't know why we have to be told this. While everyone's weeping and losing their composure, I've had said to me, you just go right on, you know, and how do you do it? Well, the Lord sustains you. I don't want to leave any wrong impressions, like you don't have emotions. But what sustains me in maintaining my stability at such a time is the knowledge of what's said here. Maybe I'll shed a tear later, you see. And that's all right, too. We're not talking about it's wrong to weep or show compassion, but we should not sorrow as those who have no hope. And it is sad that so many people in the churches have so little understanding of what the Word of God teaches about death. They're not really sure where the Christian is, what state he's in. And, of course, all of the wrong teachings about purgatory and so on and so forth. But death to the Christian is not something to be avoided at all costs. For what does it mean to be absent from the body but to be present with the Lord? That's Philippians chapter 1 verses 21 and 24, and then it's also 2 Corinthians 5:8. Philippians 1 21 to 24, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Then in 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul says essentially the same thing. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body so we can be present with the Lord. He didn't have any morbid fears of death. He said, I'd rather be absent from this body. That means dead physically, because he knows that he will be present with the Lord. Well, we live in this affluent, pampered 20th century church culture, which looks upon death like the world does oftentimes, with morbid fear. When, if you would just read a little church history, what happened in the past will happen out there in the future, but in the past they held no morbid fears because they knew to live consistently as a disciple of Jesus often was at the risk of your life. It will get that way again for some of you who wonder why we stress faith so much. Amen. Many millions, read Martyr's Mirror, that thick. Many millions have gladly followed Paul's admonition to be willing rather to be absent from the body so he can be present with the Lord. Did it with joy. Many of them tortured. But they didn't count life something to be held on to, life in the physical body something to be held on to. For death to the Christian was the doorway into Jesus' presence. Amen. Now, it doesn't mean life isn't precious. It doesn't mean that you should not show compassion for loved ones who've passed on, but a Christian properly taught will have a balance. He may sorrow, he may grieve, he may weep, but it's not despair and frustration of the world. When they bid one of their friends or relatives goodbye, it's goodbye. Till they see them in hell, but I mean, from their side, it's goodbye. From your side, it isn't goodbye. Well, it's a little bit trite to say it's so long, but in one sense, that's really all it is. So long, I'll see you later. Hallelujah. There would be something wrong with someone that didn't weep at a wife or husband or a child's mother, father, at their passing, show compassion, but it isn't, Paul said, to be as that of the world with despair and frustration that they've departed and life in this world is all there is. That speaks under the second heading of the biblical attitude toward death. The tragic nature should not be minimized. We should confront people with it. It's death due to sin. That should never be forgotten. And the other side, though, for the Christian is it's not hopeless. The funeral now. We have a text along the way in our studies in theology. We assign you certain required reading. And this one is, if you want to write it, it's a paperback, so it won't break you up. The American Way of Death. The American Way of Death by Jessica Mitford, Mitford. Now, the reason that's required reading, you ought to yourself to see what the American Way of Death signifies. It's an abomination. It's an abomination to God. It's unscriptural. It's pagan. From the beginning to the end, it's all of that. And you at least ought to read a book like that, and there's more than one. I've read more than one other titles, but this is probably the best, and a lot of deep research went into it. You'll discover even the American funeral is an invention by this culture, and it's not very old, the American way of conducting a funeral. Do you realize that we didn't even embalm until the Civil War? That's how new it is. When's the Civil War? 1865? That's just 100 years ago. That's how new it is in this country. They did in this country what they did in other cultures. A corpse is to be buried, not to be put on display and to have some unscriptural, abnormal, morbid curiosity about it so that you can display your wife or husband or child or loved one to the world in an unnatural state. Well, you need to read the book. So I don't follow up and say, did you read it? But if you didn't, the Lord will know it. I mean, this is very important that you take seriously these texts we assign you, because there's no way for me to cover here what's in that book, though I will give a summary of some of the important aspects. So the funeral, the ethical problems connected with the funeral are quite extensive, and that's why we're studying them. It's important we study the Christian attitude toward the funeral as well as death and terminal illness, because that, for the most part, funerals are motivated by commercialism and saturated with pagan concepts and ideas concerning the dead body. American funerals, the reason we're studying it is because they are largely motivated by commercialism and saturated with pagan, heathen concepts and ideas about the dead body. Also, we need to study it because these unscriptural ideas and practices are almost impossible to eradicate, never will be eradicated out there in the American culture, because other nations are picking up some of the American practices. But it's very difficult to eradicate in the church, except for those who just want to be as spiritual as they can, and they're not too many, as you know, not in proportion. The reason that it's so hard to eradicate these ideas is because at the time of death, the person is so overwrought, they just go along with the current practices. They don't know to do anything else for the most part, but even if they do, they put that question off about dealing with how they're going to conduct a funeral or conduct the aspects around the death of a loved one until it's too late, and then they just kind of go along with the usual practice. Because generally, even if they know better, they lack the courage of their convictions. They lack the courage to challenge the unscriptural pagan aspects of the American funeral. Before we get into some of the unscriptural pagan ideas, we're not just dealing with what's wrong with things in these studies and ethics, but how to deal with people who have wrong ideas and concepts, as well as how we ourselves should react in situations. And so a very important part of the understanding of the biblical attitude toward death and the funeral is the process of grief. Now, some of the things we'll teach you in this next section, we won't get through tonight, of course, are a lot deeper in their implications than it may appear to be when you first hear them. But if you get them down in your notes or your thinking, you're going to find out this is actually the way people react to the death of a person. If you understand that process, you know how to minister to that person or to help them. Now, that'll become very clear as we go on, because there is a normal and an abnormal process of grieving for a person. Some people never quit grieving. See, that would be abnormal. Some people get depressed, allow depressing spirits to come in. And psychiatrists and psychologists and doctors and so on, social workers, are aware of this. This is not hidden knowledge, but it's knowledge that's essential for our understanding the whole question we're studying. Because there's a right and wrong way to approach a person or a family. There's an ethical and unethical way. There's a scriptural, non-scriptural way. And a lot of it depends on your understanding what people are going through. Now, all human beings are members of the same race. While Christians will react a little differently than a non-Christian to death and the funeral, for the most part, there's very little difference. Some who've been taught some things, even people who've read American Way of Death, which isn't a part of the Bible, it's just some facts that are gathered that will enlighten you on the horrible way that Americans treat their dead. And that's a well-chosen word. It is pretty horrible. Those who have a little knowledge about these things will react a little differently, I'm talking about Christians now, than those who do not have any knowledge. But there's one point in which, whether you're Christian or non-Christian, being a human being, there's certain steps or patterns that a person goes through. It's like the AA, the Alcoholics Anonymous. There's a pattern a person goes through to become an alcoholic. And if you understand that, you can pretty well locate, you don't need word of knowledge or discernment, you can pretty well locate where he is in that process he's going through before he comes totally, hopelessly, incurably alcoholic. We're talking again about the human race and not what deliverance could do for the person. And so with the process of grief, it'll help you understand normal and abnormal. If I'm dealing with a person and I see after 3 months they're still very acting peculiar, let's say, I might suspect they've allowed a spirit in, you see, of depression or self-pity or many other things that we'll get into. But a person who isn't educated in these things, the way the human spirit, mind, and so forth operates, just looks at a person and really doesn't know how to cope with an abnormal reaction to a death. Now, the process of grief, we're going to mention, first of all, what's usual. It's called normal, but that's not a good term. It's called normal, but the usual process of grief, in the sense that most go through these steps. And if it's a normal reaction to grief, a grief reaction to death, it'll last generally not over 3 months, and at the most 6. Person's still grieving a year later, there's something wrong with the person. If he's a non-Christian, he's got a spirit tormenting him. If he is a Christian, he doesn't know the word, he or she, because they're still grieving as somebody that has no hope. You see what I mean? So the normal process would be 3 to 6 months. Now, these are steps everybody goes through. Some will emphasize one aspect more than the other, but first of all is the initial emotional shock. And you have to realize that everybody has that initial emotional shock at the news of the death. Doesn't matter how slow the death was in coming, you know, a long illness where it's kind of expected after a while, or how close or how relatively unclose they were to the person, yet it's always a shock. I mean, if a person died in the body, as some few have in the past, I hear the news, oh, praise the Lord, Ruth the Lord. No, I don't say that. Initial emotional shock you have, you know, even though you don't know the person very well or whatever. There's no other way. You're a human being. And so you'll react this way. The closer you are to the person, the more the shock. Even if you're expecting the death, you see. That's what we all go through, all right? And secondly, in these steps of the process of grief is the period of insensitivity. A period of emotional insensitivity. Now, during this period, there's very little you can say that gets through to the person. I don't care who they are and how much they believe 1 Thessalonians 4. I'm thinking now if they're really close to the person, mother, father, wife, husband, child. Whatever you say for the first few hours really doesn't get through to them. So what you say ought to be from God's word, because that will get through. And I'm not a talkative person. I know I preach for 2 hours and all that, but after that, especially in serious situations, they get the word or something based on the word. You don't get through to them. If you think you do, you're kidding yourself. Ministers have memorized a procedure to go through at this time, wasted their time, and are wasting their time. Just give them some word and some comfort and pray with them or whatever, but they're in a state of emotional shock, Christian or non-Christian. And it usually lasts through the funeral. Now, this is something we know from millions of people dying. It isn't like something, you know, that's kind of artificial. But if you know people are going through these processes, you know how to minister to them. I know how to deal with a person after a funeral as well as before. And there's a difference. Or 10 days later, or 6 months later, you see. Then the third step of the process is the struggle with the reality of death. Now, whether they consciously go through these things or not, people do. The struggle with the reality of death. They just have periods there in the first few hours or days struggling with the reality of the fact they've died. You know, it's hard for them to accept the fact. And they'll find themselves moments not accepting the fact. They're not dead. They couldn't be. And yet, you know, they are. So people go through this. They're not out, you know, telling you, look, I'm going through this stage. It's just happening. You have to understand it to help people. Then the fourth stage in this process is the flood of emotion and grief. That doesn't come first. That comes in this stage. It may happen very quickly in some lives, but nevertheless, this is the fourth aspect, the flood of emotion and grief. And this is at a time when you ought to let them express it. Nothing wrong with it. The Bible says Jesus wept at the tomb of Lazarus. It's all right to weep at the death of a loved one. Let it happen. If it doesn't end and it's hysterical, then there's something wrong with the person. If they're a Christian, they should not go to pieces. If the other was a Christian especially. Then fifthly, there's the transitional period. Transitional period, when they want to talk about what's happened. Not much talk before that, generally. That's when they're going to be facing reality and talk about the present and the past and start looking toward the future. It's a transitional period. Then there's a period of what could be called selective memories. Selective memories, where objects, certain rooms, clothing or pieces of furniture or certain events or restaurants will, whatever, remind them of the departed loved one. And they go through this. And it's usually pleasant. One thing about a loved one passing on, they don't try to think of the unpleasant. He may have been pretty miserable, but they only remember the good parts. That's all right, I guess. Oh, he never said an unkind word to me, I heard a woman say. And they lived together. Oh, he was about 80 when he died. I'd never seen an angel before. I'd met him before he died, but I must have met an angel. Well, if you understand the process of grief people go through, that's good. They're selecting the memories they want to remember. And if they remember the bad ones, then you see that leads into something else. And it's abnormal. And then lastly is the acceptance of the loss and the return to the normal life pattern. The acceptance of their loss and the return to the normal life pattern. Now that's going to take 3 to 6 months if it's normal, or if it's usual. This is a usual pattern. Now if you move in, you see, with all of your big ideas to help this person 2 weeks after they've lost a loved one, you're about 3 months at least ahead of schedule. It's just the way the human reacts to the tragic nature of death. Now, of course, there could be exceptions. And a person doesn't have to sit around and analyze, well, now let's see, which process am I going through so I'll know where I'm at? That isn't what we're saying. But there's just a pattern that everybody goes through, whether it's a longer or shorter period. But the normal period is 3 to 6 months. Now, there's some other things in connection with that, why it's that way and what affects it and what's abnormal, that we'll study next time.